with New York Vinnie. Drivetime Radio.
And a very good Saturday morning to you. It is just after 8 o'clock. You are listening to Drivetime Radio. I'm New York Vinnie, your congenial, happy, newly coiffed host of this radio program. But we are joined by the Ukrainian piece of art in the background that we've been using on our shows this week with Michael, and have been using as just a small way to support the people of the Ukraine who are undergoing more massive shelling this morning, bombing, just a horrible situation. And it ties into automotive because it is the excuse that many people are using that sell gasoline to jack the gasoline prices up. Prices were going up anyway before the war. The Russian oil ban that we have seen President Biden put in effect this week will affect 8-12% of the oil that we use in this country. So it's not a major factor in oil prices, but you know, people are gonna think what they want to think. And I see a lot of anti-presidential stuff on there because Biden's jacking up the oil prices. Do yourselves a favor. Do me a favor. Do mankind a favor. Go on a reputable site that deals with gas prices and oil prices and learn the mechanics of how the price is determined. The president has little to nothing to do with the price of gasoline that you're paying at the pump. And certainly not in this situation. It's not that President Biden is saying, go ahead and jack it up another five. Let's see how much they can stand. But there's somebody in a room at an oil company doing that. And there's somebody in a room at a jobber doing that. And there's somebody in a room in another place doing that. There's somebody that holds permits to be able to drill for oil on private land and on federal land. Who's saying, well, you know, let's not quite drill yet. So that's where your gas prices are being hiked from. And you can believe what you want to believe, because you're going to believe what you want to believe. You can believe that cadre of people on Facebook and Twitter and social media that have gone from being experts in communicable diseases to now being experts in the price of gasoline. It is an amazing country. You know, we always keep saying that, oh man, people are, you know, America people are dumb and they don't educated and this. No. All you need to do is look at Facebook and see the number of people who just a mere 3 or 4 months ago knew everything they needed to know about a communicable disease and how you got it and how you didn't and why you didn't have to wear a mask. And now those same people, exact same people, are experts in the pricing of gasoline. God bless America, my friends. God bless America. But anyway, we are not going to see any relief, at least in the immediate future, for gasoline prices. They are almost unbelievable when you look at the numbers, the sheer movement of the numbers over a day, over a 24-hour period, is off the charts. It's funny in one respect, and that is that we're catching up with what the rest of the world has known for a while. And it's also funny to see how many people who have these oversized vehicles are now having to either park them, use them less, or certainly start to think about selling them. I predict to you that within, 4 or 5 months, you will be able to go to any lot on Aurora and buy a huge full-size American pickup truck for a lot less than you could have the first of this year. A lot less. People are going to be dropping them like hotcakes. When it costs you $250 to fill up your car, and you're working as maybe an electrician or a plumber or something along those lines where you make decent money, but now you got to make choices between, do I drive this Jagunda pickup truck that maybe I don't really need, maybe I can get along with a smaller pickup truck, or, you know, do I go out and I find a smaller pickup truck, something that doesn't have all the luxury bells and whistles and everything like that, but will cost a lot less money to operate and to maintain? It's a question that is going to face us all. I know I have made less trips in my car over the last 2 weeks that I have. I mean, I'm a guy that gets out every day and goes for a drive. I mean, I drive these different cars, and I'm not driving them as much. You know, that long trip that I take, that 300-mile trip that I take in the car up and back to the border or over to the, wherever I'm going, or out to, Georgia or something like that, not taking that trip right now, because the price of gasoline is just ridiculously off the charts. There are a couple of things that you can do to help get more bang out of your engine, more mileage. Very simple things you can do. Very simple. That will get you at least close to the optimum mileage out of your vehicle. Here they are. No big, very common sense things. Number one, correct air inflation in your tires. Make sure that your tires are inflated to the factory recommended specifications. It is one of the simplest things in the world you can do. And I will bet you any amount of money you want to bet that if we went up on Aurora Avenue on Highway 99 and we stopped 10 cars, 9.5 of them would have the wrong amount of air pressure in the tires, accounting for heat and cold and everything like that. 9.5 out of those 10 cars would have the wrong, because it's something that is just people don't do anymore. You know, in the old days, you went to a gas station, the attendant came out and checked the tires for you. That doesn't happen anymore. So that's the number one thing you can do. The number two thing that you can do is change or clean the air filter in your car. Most cars have them in a box or on top of the carburetor. But wherever the air is taken into the engine, make sure that filter is clean. That is maybe the second most important thing you can do. You would be shocked at how many miles a gallon an air filter, a dirty clogged air filter, will cost you when you're driving your car. It's amazing, but it's true. I've seen it time and time again. If you want to spend a little extra money, get yourself a K&N air filter. They raise the gas mileage that you get out of your car. They're better filters than the original, a little bit more expensive, but the K&N filters have been proven time to time to give you 2, 3, 4 miles extra a gallon. Something to consider. They're available at, most auto supply stores, or you can get them online directly from K&N. By the way, they don't sponsor me. It's just an idea that I use them in my cars and have used them for years. And they have really done a nice job. That's K&N air filters. It'll help.
And I just want to jump in too. If you're a little uneasy about changing the oil of the K&N filter, K&N actually makes AEM, which is another brand of air filter, and they're dry flow. So you really don't need to oil and do all that extra stuff to clean it. You just,
rinse
it off and wipe it off.
Yeah,
so a little bit easier option, but made by the same brand.
Yeah, it's an easy thing you can do to give yourself a few more miles a gallon. Even if you just used, if you don't want to change it, you just want to stick with whatever make you have and just use a regular Fram or whatever filter is available. The clean air filter will pay off. Believe you me, even if you just blow it out, it's one of the things that nobody looks at. That, they look at it when you go in for service, but nobody looks at these things, but yet it's an important part of getting the maximum amount. The third thing is clean your trunk out. The stuff you have in your trunk, especially if you were one of those people like me who carry tools or they carry luggage or they carry a snowblower, 10,000 heavy pieces of whatever it is in the back of the car, in the trunk of your car, will add weight to your car, which will decrease the mileage that you get in your car. Again, take the stuff out of the trunk of your car that you carry around in there and put it in your garage. Again, it's not going to give you 20 miles more a gallon, but it's going to give you something. It's going to, it's going to help you out. It's going to lower the weight of the car and the weight of the car. And this is something I'm doing too. You can also lose a little weight if you need to, like me. That'll probably give you, you laugh, but being somebody who has gone up and down in their body weight over the course of my lifetime, there has been definitely an improvement in gas mileage I get when I am lighter as opposed to heavier. You think about it and you say, all right, how much could it be? But I remember one year I tracked it when I was on a diet. I think it was on Nutrisystem one year. And I think I got a couple of miles extra a gallon when I was at the lower end of my weight, around 200 pounds, 225 pounds, than I was when I'm at the higher end, as I am now. So you can save money on food and on gasoline. So those are the immediate things that I can tell you to do to your car. Make sure it's tuned up. Make sure that the plugs are clean and correctly gapped, the spark plugs. We talked about the air filter, but your gas filter, any other mechanical devices like that have to do with gasoline are in proper working order. And I think you will be shocked at how much your mileage increases on a 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 year old car, just on those items alone. And plus, the safety factor of having your tires correctly inflated cannot be overstated. You know, there's so many things that can go wrong when you have the wrong amount of air pressure in your tires. Handling problems, problems in a curve, blowouts. I mean, so many dangerous things can happen to you. So those are just four quick things that you can look at on your car to improve and get more bang for the buck out of your gallon of gas. And it's so important in these days, so important, because I don't think the gas is going to start dropping anytime soon. I just don't see that on the horizon. So I think that those things right there, something you can use today. You can do it this afternoon when you go out to the car wash to wash your car off, or when you go to Costco or wherever you go today. Find yourself an air or just drive into it. If you can't do it, drive into a Les Schwab, drive into a Costco tire center, drive into one of these places and ask them if they have a couple of minutes. You have to wait a couple of minutes, but if they have a couple of minutes to check your tires, make sure they're properly inflated. It's just, I can't overstate the importance of doing that. A couple of other things real quickly that we have. Volkswagen made some news this week by introducing the production version of their electric ID Buzz, which is their minivan, which looks like and feels like, there you see it, the Volkswagen bus of days gone by, which was an extremely popular car. As a matter of fact, when I saw this, I said, if you've seen Jimi Hendrix, Janis Joplin, or The Doors live, the car you are waiting for is here. Now, this, and I think it's a stunning looking car, all electric. I think that the ID Buzz is going to make people fall in love with minivans again. I just look at it and I say, it's not only is it sustainable mobility, not only is it electric and it's not going to use gasoline, but it goes back to that microbus that so many people loved. Many people also cursed at it because if you were trying to go up a hill behind one, good Lord, it took you a week. But it's just a stunning vehicle that brings back the Volkswagen tradition and also makes sense for today's world. The first versions that are going to be sent into the European market will have a 200 horsepower electric motor, 229 pound-feet of torque. Leather will be replaced with non-animal materials, recycled materials, organically based paint. You will have the Europe, and also you're going to have the panel van, which I love. I love these things. I mean, you talk about cars that you're going to see on the road. Excuse me. These will be introduced this year for sale in Europe. A longer wheelbase passenger model comes into our market, the North American market, in 2023, and will go on sale in 2024. So it's still going to be a little bit of a wait for it. But, the concept has been floating around for a while, a concept vehicle. But this is what the production version is going to look like, albeit with a few changes here and there. But a stunning, I think, vehicle that, mixes up the old and the new. For those of you who remember these vehicles, they were fun. They were, you could throw 10 friends into it and go to the beach and go here and go there. And it was the hippie bus. How many people got to Washington and got to California in one of these things from back east or wherever they were coming from? But the DNA is there. The VW logo is present on the front of it like any old ones. And it really looks cool. I can't wait to see if they do what I hope they will do, and that is make the pickup truck version of these. And you see them around. You know, it's got that, it looks like a flatbed. It's got the cab, but it cuts off right behind the doors. And it has the flatbed where the sides fold down, one of the most practical pickup trucks you've ever seen. And just a work of art. Not only is it a car, but it's a work of art. Again, all electric. And it's going to have all of the safety features. If there was one knock on the old Volkswagen bus, it was that you were sitting right up on top of the road. Something hit you in the front. You you didn't have much of any protection in front of you. This has, as you can see there, a little bit of hood in front of it. And again, all electric. It is really, I think, going to be pretty a pretty popular vehicle. I don't think you will get. Be able to get one right off the bat unless you know a Volkswagen dealer. The one thing that I thought was interesting when I was reading about this is it's going to have a top speed of 145 miles per hour. Excuse me, 145 kilometers an hour, which translates to about 90 miles per hour. And I've gone 90 miles an hour in a Volkswagen bus. But it was definitely a harrowing experience. I'm sure that these are going to be a lot safer, a lot more family friendly. So it'll be interesting. And by the way, this will not be the first electric Volkswagen bus. They actually premiered one many, many years ago in Europe. It had a rear-mounted electric motor. It had a 52-mile range, and it was something that Volkswagen was very high on, even back then, 50 years ago, on electric vehicles for the urban part, customer that used these probably more mainly. I mean, I think most flower shops had a Volkswagen van as a delivery vehicle, didn't they? So that's the big news. The other big news this week from the automotive world was the introduction by Honda, actually Acura, of the Acura Integra. They are bringing those back in a hatchback style. Very, very cool vehicle that many people, especially young people, desire this Acura Integra. And they've styled it up. They put it on 17 or 18 inch wheels and really made it a really sharp looking car based about on the Civic hatchback. The shape is there, as you can see. Well, you can't see because I don't think I sent Nathan the picture of it, but...
Kind of reminds me of the front of like a Honda Civic, and then the back is like a Genesis coupe.
Yeah, yeah, it's got it. Can you post a picture of it by any chance, Nathan?
Let's probably not do that since I had to grab it from somewhere that's probably got the ownership rights.
Most of the pictures are all right. I'll see if I can grab it on this end, which I think I'm looking at the Acura media site, and let's see if we can. Anyway, I don't want to spend so much time on it, but a very sharp looking car, and one that I think Acura is going to give you an upscale Honda Civic. The kids will love them. It'll be a great car that will be actually introduced at the right time, which is a good on gas little luxury vehicle that has some zippiness to it. And I think
interesting that it's a four door.
Excuse me.
Pretty interesting that it's a four door.
Yeah, I think they'll probably be at some point. Honda traditionally does two door versions of their vehicles, some of their vehicles as well. I don't know if they'll go down to the Civic. I know the Accord had a two door version that people loved. As a matter of fact, I helped a friend of mine buy a two door standard shift Accord not so many years ago, like 3 or 4 years ago, I guess. And she loved the car. She thought, she still has it. She still loves it. This car will be available with a standard shift, I am hearing. It will cost you more money in a strange twist. It'll cost you more money to buy a standard shift Acura than it will to buy the automatic. A complete reversal from the other days. So that is, that's something that you will, that we'll have more information on as the weeks roll by, but certainly an interesting vehicle for a lot of people, something to keep the Honda owners happy. But, going back to the Volkswagen, both of these marks, the Integra and the Volkswagen, vehicles that you haven't seen around for a while, and will now be back in the automotive public consciousness. Also want to mention this morning that our friends at Shoreline Cars and Coffee, if we were out there a couple of weeks ago, they have moved their location in the lot. So if you happen to be driving down to Cars and Coffee in Shoreline and you don't see them in right there where they usually were, in the parking lot in front of the market, look in front of China Buffet. The people at China Buffet have graciously allowed them to park in their lot. So you have to look a little bit more, but it's worth it. It's a nice morning. And I think, going to Cars and Coffee is a great way to talk about cars, listen to the show. It's almost like if the show was presented in feel around, you could go and you can look and look at all the cars that are out there. Right, time now for our favorite segment, which we couldn't do last week because Nathan decided that he wanted to go back and visit his new little niece. So now we have him back again after his long trip there to the East Coast. Nathan, what do you got for us this morning, Nathan?
Yo, Vinny, what are you driving this week?
Oh, Nathan. First, let's ask you, Nathan, how are you? How was your trip?
I thought you were going to ask me what I was driving when I was in Kentucky.
Well, I'll get there. Don't rush me. My God, this guy, we give him a couple of shots on the air now, all of a sudden. And when I go on vacation, I'll just let you host the show. How was your trip, first of all?
Oh, it was excellent. I mean, of course, the best part, even more than a cherry on top was holding little Genevieve in my arms for the first time. And boy, there's no feeling like that when you just take your first niece, nephew, daughter, son, whatever it is, newest member of the family, and hold them in your arms and cradle them and bounce up and down and really a lot of love.
Yeah.
And this immediate connection.
It really is. So does that make you now, want to be a father?
It makes me, I gotta be the godfather. That was part of the deal when I was going out there, and the reason why was so I could be at the baptism and become the godfather for little Genevieve.
There you go, man. There you go. Well, congratulations.
In addition to being the uncle.
What did you drive when you were back there?
We had a Honda Accord, I believe it was the LE version, pretty base model that we got in from the rental car.
Yeah.
2019, I think it was, because I was surprised to see that it was a 2019, because usually you get a more recent, but I guess with the car shortage, they've been holding on to their cars for a little bit longer.
Yeah, what company are you renting from?
It was Budget. Well, we went through Costco, but ended up getting to Budget. Yeah.
Their car rental prices are phenomenal, Costco. With the different companies that they, so you liked it. It was roomy, right? It gave you enough room and enough power. It's Yeah, I think some of the fleets are holding on right now because it's tough to get, number one, it's tough to get cars. Number two, it's the cost of the cars is up. And number three, I think they're looking at the used car market, seeing, you know, if it's going to increase and maybe hanging on to the cars, figuring they'll sell them for more at a later date. Who knows? I don't sell rental cars. Right, well, let me tell you about what I'm driving this week. What am I driving this week? Oh, yes. Took me a second to figure it out. They have the Subaru Forrester Wilderness Edition. It's a great little car. We drove the Outback Wilderness Edition, I don't know, 5 weeks ago. And I don't know, maybe this will jog your memory a little bit. I parked it out in front of a Trader Joe's and immediately had people like, you know, gathered around it and looking at it and kind of, you know, checking it out a little bit. And some a lot of it. Well, last night I figured I'll go a different direction. I parked it in front of the PCC down here on Edmonds Way, and same reaction. There's a parking lot where if you drove in with a brand new Corvette, somebody would say, But drive in with a hopped up Subaru, and it's much a different story. Inside, the car is comfortable. This one happens to be in a camouflage green type color. It looks like almost like an army vehicle with black wheels. And it, it looks the part. It looks like you're driving, an army vehicle almost. But it's a very cool green, a military green color with black trim, black claddings, and so on and so forth on it. If you want to look at pictures of it, I'll put them up on our Facebook page here in right after the show. And it's just a very, very, it's a Forester. It's a Subaru Forester, so it gives you all of that stuff. Plus, they also install special suspension and other special items that make the car much more adaptable to go off-road. Some of the knocks on Subarus have been that it's a great car, it's great in the snow, but maybe you don't want to take it too far off-road. Subaru, I think, is trying to fight that image a little bit with this series of Wilderness. This car, as you'll see in the commercials that you see on TV for, which are very well done, might I add, the car is, they are trying to toughen up their image a little bit, if you will, faced with the competition of, a new electric Hummer, the Ford Bronco, and other off-road vehicles, the Jeeps that are coming out. And, people are, they're trying to get into that a little further off-road category. That this one will take you up to the top of the mountain as opposed to just the cabin and let you hike the rest of the way up. Very sharp car, very enjoyable car, and we'll have a full review of it next week, but certainly a car that I'm excited about driving and very excited about also because I'm a student of how people react to cars. Definitely like seeing people's reaction to this car. It's something worth seeing. All right, we'll take a quick break here. We'll come back, talk a little bit about a car that is near and dear to my heart. It's a classic car. We sometimes tell stories about classic cars, and we will do that today. This is Drive Time Radio. I'm New York Vinnie. Nathan, the producer, is along for the ride, as he is almost every Saturday morning. And we're here to service your automotive needs on 1150 KKNW.
Well, 56 is almost gone. Only three more days. We made a lot of friends, sold a lot of Chevrolet. But let's not wait till New Year's Eve at sometime past 11. Let's go explore what lies in store for 1957. May May 57 bring you all that's best along the way. Good health, good friends, good times galore in your new Chevrolet. The big buy in the low price field will win in any test. All point by point comparison shows Chevy leads the rest. May you enjoy the special air of springtime, clean and new. Enjoy it every bit as much inside your Chevy, too. The outside air can breeze right through this brand new intake vent, improving air supply as much as 22%. May friends add to your happiness, and may days be filled with fun. And may you often have a chance to choose your favorite one. In Chevrolet, you have a choice no other car can touch. Five engines, five transmissions. Only Chevy has so much. And may you reap the harvest of the highways across the land. And when again the end of one more year is close at hand, and you count all the good things that you've gained along the way, perhaps the best of all the rest will be your Chevrolet. And although our show is far from being over, on behalf of your authorized Chevrolet dealer, let me wish you a very happy New Year.
Get inspired every hour, right here on Alternative Talk 1150.
All right, back with you here on Drivetime Radio, New York City, hanging out on a Saturday morning. And we thank you for coming along for the ride with us, because without you hanging out with us, what would the show, what would life be? Anyway, I wanted to take a moment this morning to pay tribute to, from time to time, for certain reasons, we delve into cars of the past, because we know that a lot of people that listen to this show like the cars that are out there today, but also that we like to hip you up, as they might say, to the cars that are out there that are no longer. And one of those cars that I decided to pick this morning to alert you to it, if you have never seen it, but I'm sure many of you have, is maybe one of America's unsung cars, the Ford Falcon. Why, Vinnie, did you pick the Ford Falcon? Well, it's a simple reason. My lovely sister, Mary Ann, who is turning, she's having a major milestone birthday tomorrow. And I'm not going to tell you how old, because it's really not polite, right? To say, I don't know, it's old school, it's sexist and everything like that. But I was taught that, a woman's age, I'll leave it up to them to tell you what it is. I don't know why, but that's what, so I'll honor that. Anyway, Mary Ann is, my younger sister, and I love her dearly. She has been just this incredible person in my life. And early on in her driving career, she for some reason, I don't remember exactly how it all came about, but she fell in love. Her second true love, besides her husband, is the Ford Falcon. She had a 68 or 67 Ford Falcon, two-tone blue with a dark blue on the bottom, a light blue on the top, and a lighter blue interior that was, I think in many ways, about as close as a person and a car can get, did Mary Ann get with the Ford Falcon. It took her everywhere. As a matter of fact, it took me and her and more across the country and back on what can only be described for Marianne as a trip of torture. We needed to go cross country. My brother and I need to go cross country, and we decided to take a camper. And on the last day before we were supposed to leave, the camper's motor blew up and we couldn't take it. So we turned to Marianne and said, how would you like to take a trip to California? And she looked at us and said, no, not really. And we looked at her and said, oh, how would you like to take a trip to California? And she said, no, I don't know if I want to go. And then we looked at her and said, well, you better take a trip to California because you got a car that runs. And so we hijacked her into this trip. And we went across country. We drove from New York out to Malibu and back again. And wow. And really, we're very mean to her on the trip. As brothers and sisters, you know how that works. Anyway. But the car we took across country was her Falcon. And it was an amazing car. It got us everywhere we needed to go. It was small enough that it was good on gas and big enough that it allowed us to fight with each other and not have to sit directly next to each other. The Ford Falcon came about really in the late 50s. It was thought up at Ford as a car that saw the future of cars. That it was, the big cars might not always be the cars that people wanted going into the showroom. And American Motors proved this with the Rambler. From the Rambler, people started saying, and Studebaker, the Lark, people started saying, well, maybe America wants a less humongous, better, smaller car. And so the Falcon was born to really go up against the Chevrolet Corvair. Both of them hit the market in October 1959. Also Plymouth with the Valiant as well. The Falcon was probably the more conservative out of those three, as the Plymouth had the great Chrysler styling, and the Chevy Corvair, of course, was rear-engined, and gee, only the Germans did that at that time. Anyway, introduced in 59, 144-cylinder, six-cylinder, 144 cubic inch, made about 90 horsepower, and was... really kind of took America by surprise. They started selling them. But what was more interesting is a lot of people started making hot rods out of them because of the weight of the car and the feel of the car. It was a smaller car. And so Ford responded to this by making a Futura model. And also building it in a Ranchero, a small pickup style. But the Futura models added some style and some with bucket seats and a floor shifter and some other and things that they put in there. And also, by the time it was all said and done, a V8 engine. And with the V8 and the four speeds, these cars really started to take off among the younger set that wanted a little bit of speed. Almost a million Falcons built in the first 2 years alone. Now, you can see something happening here with the Falcon. Yes, you can. All of a sudden, engineers are saying, well, wait a minute, this chassis can also be used, or this body can also be used, this platform can also be used to make a sportier car. So why don't we do that? So while they had the Sprint, they also said, well, you know, Lee Iacocca said, let's make a little more of a sports car. And so in 1964 and a half, the Mustang was introduced. Same platform. Falcon Mustang, you take the fenders and everything off, same car. model change, a major change in 1964. The rancheros, convertibles, hardtops, and even vans now with V8 power and six, they kept the sprint around, but after a while started to knock it off because they wanted to push the Mustang, and the Mustang came along. But that design that came out in 1966 really forced the Falcon, or that design that came out in 64 and a half with the Mustang, really forced the Falcon back into being more of a family car, a people mover, as opposed to a hot rod. They took away the hard tops, they took away the convertibles, you had two and four door sedans, you had wagons and rancheros. And they did do a sports coupe a little bit later, but it was a very smartly styled, it had a little bit of the Mustang look to it, not a lot. They didn't have the slanted grille, you didn't have the short, but you had a longer hood, a shorter deck, and some other interesting items that really, you know, made it into production, into the design. But again, the Falcon was reverted back to being a family car. Also, they took it off the Mustang platform, which was now, instead of the Falcon platform, was now known as the Mustang platform. And they switched it over to a shortened Fairlane, which was their midsize Chevelle fighter. And it was an interesting car that handled nicely, had enough power for what it needed, and was again, with the two-tone colors and so on and so forth, really fit the bill for a smaller car. In many ways, it was a better car than the Nova until 68, when the Nova went with a different design and I think eclipsed the Falcon. Anyway, the car continued until 1970 and a half, when they discontinued the Falcon because the Ford Maverick came out. And that was really essentially the new Falcon. But they brought the Falcon back in 1970 and a half as a Torino. So you had a two-door, four-door, and a four-door wagon. It only lasted a half a year, but that was the huge Falcon. And you could actually buy a 429 cubic inch Super Cobra Jet Falcon in its last year, maybe the fastest Falcon, production Falcon ever put out there. Very big in the racing environment. Holman Moody and Bill Strop brought V8 Falcons in NASCAR and in drag racing, and it really became iconic cars at that time as road racers, at European rally racers, and drag racers, and also in Monte Carlo. Now, the Falcon continued in Australia for many, many, many years. Matter of fact, to this day, but with things going the way they're going in the world, a lot of people fear that the Falcon nameplate will finally end in that configuration, although I think that the Falcon will wind up as a vehicle that, as a nameplate that will find its way onto another Ford here in America. So Marianne's Falcon, as I said, was a light blue on top of dark blue. It was a spectacular car. It took her places that I think she never thought she would go before in her car. And so I tribute the Falcon today as a celebration of her birthday, but also as an apology, I guess, in some ways for putting her through the road trip from hell. But hopefully I've made up for it in years where I've become more mature, a little bit smarter, and certainly more of a human being than I was at 18 and 19 years old. All right, we'll take quick break here. Come back. We got a quick cartoon for you.
And, let's just go ahead and do the cartoon now since we're running a little bit short on time.
Okay, let's go ahead and do the cartoon now. The Volkswagen bus that we talked about before. Well, guess what? We found a cartoon with the guy paying tribute to his Volkswagen bus. So let's hear it from... Let's hear from country artist Jake Owen and his Volkswagen bus.
Probably had to fade this early so that we can get to the road test. Yeah. Is that all right?
Yep.
I'll fade out during the second chorus.
On the road again, just like Willie, free old hillbilly gypsy soul. Gonna run out to Idaho, but I don't know. Baby, ready, set, go. Who wants to ride? Who wants to roll? Westbound, southbound, where the wind blows. Who needs a plan? Bring the whole fam.
Stand by.
All up in my VW van. All right, there's Jake Owen and VW van. Great little song about the VW bus that we talked about earlier in the show. He's talking about the older one. You know, we're talking about the new ID bus, but the concept and the idea is the same. And we thank him for that. That's our Saturday morning cartoon brought to you every Saturday morning because cars and music go together so well. All right, time now for our little testy test that we do.
The Drive Time Radio Road Test. Every week, Vinny puts another car through its paces and lets you know the good, the bad, and the ugly.
Yes, the good, the bad, the ugly. Well, I'm not going to say anything ugly about the Ford Escape Hybrid 2022 that I drove last week. Great vehicle. I know I was originally going to do the Kia this week, but I decided to change over to the Ford Escape Hybrid because, I don't know. I just did. Sorry about that. The Escape Hybrid, very, very solid vehicle if you're looking for the second year that they've gone over to this configuration. Very, very good on fuel. I mean, you know, you got the plug-in hybrid, which allows you to go about 40 or 50 miles or most of your around town driving on pure electric. So that right there is going to save you tons of money when you look at this thing. I thought it was a very roomy vehicle. First of all, from the outside, very sharp vehicle, very good looking vehicle. It you know, carries that Ford SUV DNA. Front seats that are accommodating, supportive. I drove this down to California and back this car and was really, really impressed with it. As far as the handling and the dynamics of it, I probably would have liked to see a bit more of an upgraded materials in the cabin. You know, a little more softer touch stuff. But again, it was more than adequate. This is not a luxury vehicle, an Escape. It's kind of a utilitarian. Put the family in the car. Let's go for pizza type of vehicle. And in that sense, it was very good. It had a nice soft, flat floor in the back. So you had more leg room. It didn't feel cramped. It had plenty of space to put luggage and things like that. Seated five people comfortably and really did a nice job of being a utilitarian vehicle that you could enjoy.
One minute.
driving range, as I said, was about 37 to 40 miles. And it really handled well, rode well, all of the stuff that you would look at as far as infotainment system was easily accessible, worked perfectly. This car is going to cost you in the neighborhood of about $36,000 to $40,000 if you want one very well equipped.
Wrap up.
Goes up against a RAV4 and a Tucson. Definitely worth looking at. Another edition of Drive Time goes into the books. We thank you very much. My throat is a little ravaged here, so I apologize for that. But we'll see you next week. If the Lord's will and the creek don't rise, right here on Drive Time Radio. Thank you for listening.
The views expressed on this program are those of the host, guests, and callers, and not necessarily those of KKNW.
All right, we're all clear.
Okay, sorry that we back there you're watching us on Facebook. Sorry, my computer blew out completely here, and I could not find the page I was looking for. So we had to switch from the Kia to the Ford because I had notes in front of me on the Ford that I could just read off of live radio. That happens sometimes. So we'll have the Kia for you next week. And we did the Ford this week. One other thing to let you know about on that, it is a CVT drivetrain, the plug-in hybrid model, which I like because you can use it in electric mode longer. The Escape hybrid gets 44 mpg in the city, 37 on the highway. And it gives you 105 mpg equivalent. The battery pack, 3.5 hours if you use a 240 volt charger at a level two, a little quicker if you use the rapid charge. So, and by the way, they'll tow about 1,500 pounds. So a small trailer will easily be towed with the hybrid. All right, that will do it for us on Facebook as well. We thank you so much for listening to the show this morning. And to my beautiful sister, Marianne, happy birthday. And I hope you enjoyed the tribute to Marianne's favorite car, the Falcon. Have a good week. Take care, folks.